in this regard? Thanks for watching. Now I would like to give brief introduction about today's speaker, Mr. Sumit Bhonjo. He is presently working as an assistant professor, Department of Computer Science, Government General Degree College, Shillong. He has done his M.Tech from West Bengal University of Technology. His research area of interest is machine learning and deep learning. I would like to request Mr. Sumit Bhonjo to deliver his lecture.
Thank you, Anupam. Anupam, am I audible?
Yes.
Thank you, Anupam. First of all, before starting my lecture, I want to express my deepest gratitude to our principal, sir, our IQC coordinator madam, and all the fellow colleagues of my department as well as the other department of Government General Degree College. They had always helped me and support me, and they had also encouraged me to give the lecture in such a platform. And I also give my immense thanks to all the participants. They give their time to listen my lecture. Thank you very much. Now I'm going to start my lecture. Is it visible? Anupam, is it visible?
Yes, visible.
Okay. Now, today's topic of lecture is a journey from simple to deep artificial neural network. I have planned this lecture for all the students or the participants or who wants to take footstep in the field of artificial neural network, deep learning. So I have planned that to give the interest of the basic of the artificial neural network, to give the idea about the basic of the artificial neural network, and the journey will be ended when we will how we can develop a deep learning model or how we can deployment a deep learning project. Now I have planned my journey in three steps. The first of all, the basic concept of the artificial neural network. The second part of my lecture will be the concept of deep learning, deep neural network, that is like deep learning. And last one is the how to implement a deep learning project. Let's start. First of all, before starting any topic, we have to know why. What is ANN? What is artificial neural network? So artificial neural network, basically, it is computing system, efficient computing system, whose central theme is borrowed from the biological neural network. And the main objective of the artificial neural network to develop a system that can perform the various computational tasks parallelly. That means it can be performed much more faster compared to the traditional systems. And that neural network or that artificial neural network can store the experimental knowledge and making it available for the future use. So that is the two parts of the artificial neural network that make it that much popular. Now, artificial neural network resembles with the brain in the two aspects. First of all, the knowledge which is acquired by the network through its learning process that is being imitated by the artificial neural network from the human brain. At the same time, the interconnection or interneuron connections, then known as the synaptic waves, are used to store the knowledge. And that two points are mimicked by the artificial neural network in their architecture. Now, before going to discuss about the detail about the artificial neural network, first of all, we have to know what is the biological neural network and what is the artificial neural network. There are some suitable differences between the biological neural network and the artificial neural network. Now, in the left side of the picture, we can see that the picture of the biological neural network, and in the right side of the picture, that is the artificial neural network. In the biological neural network, there is a neuron is present, and the neuron, in that neuron, there are two neurons present, the neurons which take the information from the outside world, that are called, that is the tree-like structure, that are called the dendrites. And the dendrites are responsible for taking the information from the outside world, and there is a cell body. There is a cell body that is the yellow circle is present over here. That is called the cell body, also called the soma, and that is the main part of the artificial neural or nail part of the biological neural network that is used to process the information. And after that, there is the axons are there. Axons are the basically it is the interconnection that transmit the process data from one part to the other part. And after that, at the end part, there is a synapses, and that are basically transfer the data that are connected to the dendrite of the other neuron. That is the transfer the information, process information from one neuron to other neuron. And contradictory from this biological neural network, the artificial neural network has the same type of architecture.
Sorry to interrupt.
Okay.
The slides are not moving on the screen.
Slides are not
only the from
slides are not visible.
Visible, but only the
first slide is there.
Okay. Is it changing?
No, only
the first slide.
Okay,
journey from CBN.
Okay, just a minute. Is it visible? Is it visible, Sandipan?
Visible on the front slide.
Okay, I'm starting presenting the slide.
A slide is visible.
Now, whether it is changing?
Still stuck. No.
something that may be network problem. It is not changing, no? Still in the first slide?
Yes.
Yes.
It is in the PDF mode.
No, no, but it is not the PDF form. Full screen mode is visible? Full screen mode, is it in full screen mode?
No, no. The side panels are visible also.
Okay.
Cross.
Now is it full screen mode?
No.
No, no.
Okay, there is some problem, suppose. Now?
Yes,
the first slide have full screen mode. Next slide, full screen. Yes. Sorry.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Well, this is the point where we are stuck. There are just some differences between the artificial neural network and the biological neural network. In the left side of the picture, we can see the diagram or picture of the biological neural network. In the right hand side, we can see the artificial neural network. The biological neural network, the tree-like structure, is called the dendrites, which is used to accept the information. Basically, it is treated as the input of the neuron. And next part is the cell body, which is called the soma, and that is responsible for performing this information. Basically, it is used for the processing purpose. Then there is an axon surface presents, and that are used to transfer, that is the interconnection, and that are used to transfer the process information. And the lastly, at the end, there is a synapse there, and synapses of one neuron is connected to the dendrite of the other neuron, and that are used to transfer the information from one neuron to another neuron. That are mainly the basic structure of the artificial biological neural network. The students of the biological science can say better than me, but basically this is the basic concept of the biological neural network. And the right hand side, that is the artificial neural network. The artificial neural network, there are the circles are there. Here the circles are called the node. Node are called the processing elements. That's similar to the soma of the biological neural network. And the inputs of that neuron, inputs of the neurons are treated are considered as the dendrite, and the output of the neuron are considered as the axons, and the weight associated with that neuron is called the synapse. So every node in that network, in that artificial neural network, there are multiple nodes are there, that means multiple processing elements are there, and all the processing elements can perform simultaneously. And if I consider a single neuron, that is the yellow circle, there is an interconnection line, there is incoming line, and there is the outgoing line. And that incoming line, that is the input of the neuron, and the outgoing line, that is the output of the neuron, and the yellow circle is the processing element, that is the node. Now, if I compare the different criteria with the biological neural network with the artificial neural network, we can see that the biological neural network have the massive parallel processing units, but it is superior than the artificial neural network. Whereas artificial neural network has the large number of or massive parallel processing unit it is faster than the biological neural network, but it is inferior than the biological neural network. If I say the size, the biological neural network had 10 to the power 11 neurons and 10 to the power 15 interconnection, whereas the artificial neural network can have only 10 to the power 2 to 10 to the power 4 nodes. Whereas if we are using the deep learning architecture, in that case, that can be say 10 to the power up to 10 to the power 6 number of nodes can be there. So in case of the size, the structure of the biological neural network is much, much higher or much more complex compared to the artificial neural network. And if we consider the learning, the biological neural network can tolerate ambiguity, whereas to tolerate the ambiguity, artificial neural network might be very, that data must be very precise, structured, and formatted. And in case of the biological neural network, the performance will degrade even in the partial damage. If there is a partial damage in the neurons, in that case, there will be the performance of that inter-system biological neural network will be degraded. Whereas artificial neural network can give the robust performance even on the failure of the or partial fault of the network. If we consider the storage capacity, the store the information in artificial neural network, store the information in the form of information in synapse, whereas biological neural network store the information in the synapse, whereas artificial neural network store information in continuous memory locations. Now we are coming to the, what are the benefits? Why we are using the artificial neural network? What are the benefits have that's why we are interested to use the artificial neural network. The artificial neural network has a large variety of or large number of benefits are there. First of all, the non-linearity. So that type of network, that type of artificial neural network can model the non-linear structure. That means if a structure, if a input set is the physical phenomenon of that input set is the non-linear, that can be modeled using the artificial neural network. And second is the adaptability, that can cope with the changes of the environment. If the changes environment has been changes, it can adapt with the changes with the environment. Next is the evidential response. And whatever the decisions is made by the artificial neural network, there must be a justification about that. And so that is the another important features of the artificial neural network. Next one is the massive parallelism. So there are the large number of computing devices are there. That means the computing nodes are there that can perform perform the operation in parallel. So it is faster computation is possible than that traditional computing processes. The robustness is another important feature, is the robustness. If we have given the some data set and and the artificial neural network can handle, if the data set contains some missing values or some confusing data or some noisy data are there, so the artificial neural network, even though there is a missing values or confusing data or noisy data, artificial neural network can give the stable performance, whereas the normal standard models cannot do that thing. And the fault tolerance, the artificial neural network ability to work at least one extent even of the component if in the component failure, some of the, if the some of the components are failed, in that case the artificial neural network can perform can work at least to some extent. And input output mapping, the ability to model an arbitrary input to output mapping. Optimality is the another important features of the artificial neural network as regards the error in performance. Optimality is the lowest errors compared to the traditional models, and that means its accuracy is better compared to the traditional models. And VLSI implementation is suited for the implementation, VLSI implementation, this is another features of the artificial neural network. So these are the features that make the artificial neural network that much popular. Now, today's artificial neural network is come through the different eras. Different eras means different development eras. And that era is, I am dividing that era. In that lecture, I divide that era into three phases. First of all, during 1940 to 1960, and 1960 to 1980, and 1980 to till date. So there are the three different category is the older age, middle age, or the current age. So I'm dividing that thing, that history into three different parts. And they are, at the same time, in each era or each age, I'm going to discuss some of the well-established or popular achievement of the in the field of the artificial neural network. So in 1943, the psychologist Juan Macluse and the mathematician Walter Pitts developed a new model that is the artificial neural network. So the my fellow colleagues of the psychologists can get, be interested that the psychologists have the immense contribution in the field of the artificial neural network. Yes, it is true. And in 1956, Taylor's introduced an associative memory network. And 1958, another great achievement have been done, and that is invented by the that is the perceptual learning algorithm is developed, and that is developed by the or invented by the Rosenfeld, and they developed that perceptual learning algorithm for the Macluse speed neurons. And 1960, another two achievements have been recorded. That is the Adeline and Madeline network that are developed by the Brandon Widrow and Marcian Hoff. Now in the Middle Age, that is the year of 1960 to 1980. There are a lot of achievements have been done, or a lot of research work have been done on the artificial neural network. And some of the major achievements is that in 1961, the backpropagation multilayer networks have been proposed by the Rosenfeld, but still he is unsuccessful to implement that thing, but that idea is a great idea. And in 1969, multilayer perceptron was invented by the Minsky and Papert. And 1971, the Cohen developed the associative memory. And another great achievement in the 1974, the backpropagation learning method is introduced by the Waves. And the Waves is the backpropagation learning, not only introduced, successfully implement that thing. And 1976, Stephen Grossberg and the Gil Carpenter developed the adaptive resonance theory. These are the major achievements in the year of 1960 to 1980s. Now we are coming to the 1982 till present. In 1982, the major development was the Hopfield's energy approach. 1985, the Boltzmann machine was introduced by the Ackley and Hinton, Ackley, Hinton, Asinowski. And 1986, Rummelhardt, Hinton, and Williams introduced the generalized delta rules. 1980, Costco developed the binary associative memory, that is the, called the popularly known as the BAM, and also give the concept of the fuzzy logic in artificial neural network. And in 1990, another achievement is there, the artificial neural network is successfully applied in the medicine, marketing, risk management, and indeed this is another breakthrough of the artificial neural network. Now, I'm going to discuss about the some of the artificial neural network models. First of all, that is the simple, the Macluse speed models of neurons that is the first introduced by the Macluse speed in 1943. The basic structure of the neuron is that there are the there are certain number of inputs here, x1, x2, x, x3, xm number of inputs are there, and there are there is a processing element that is called the adder. Adder is the processing element, and the, every input unit is connected with the processing elements or processing nodes, and that is associated, and that connection is associated with a weight, that is the W1, W2, W3, like that, Wm. And there is a bias is there, and that adder unit or that processing elements find the summation, a multiplicative summation of all that inputs. That means the Yin, that means the net input is of that adder is the Yin, that is the x1 w1 plus x2 w2 plus x3 w3 plus ... like that xm wm plus b. B is the bias over here. Now that is the net input can be explained in like that. Mathematically we can represent that Yin equals to b plus summation of 1 to m xi wi. That is the mathematically we can represent that. And output y equals to some function of yn. That function is called the activation function. And the net input, within the net input, and the function is applied, and that function is called activation function. The output of that activation function, basically, this is the output of the model. Now I'm giving the simple example of the two input artificial neural network. Suppose we have some data points are there, and that data points I am representing the plotted in the two-dimensional graph. That there are some blue lines. There are the blue squares are there, and there are the some red circles are there. The main purpose or main motivation or main utility of this artificial neural network to classify that two type of different type of data points, or segregate that two different type of data points. If I say the red points, red circles will be belong to the class 0, and blue square will be belong to the class 1. Now, the how that the artificial neural network can classify, generate the classify boundary. So that's why when we give some inputs, and based on that inputs, the neural network can say whether it belongs to the class 0 or it belongs to the class 1. Now, X1 and X2, capital X1 and X2, these are the capital X1 and X2, these are the input neurons. Input neurons, here the Y is the output neuron, and X1, small X1 and X2 are the inputs, and the W1 is the weight associated between the input neuron X1 to the output neuron Y, and W2 is the weight associated between the input neuron X2 with the output neuron Y. And there is another concept, is the B is the bias. Bias is also connected to the output neuron. And output neuron, there is the output of this neuron, capital Y, is the output Y. Now, capital Y, the equals to the net input of that processing elements or output neuron, that is the W1 X1 plus W2 X2 plus B. And after that net input, within the net input, we apply some activation function, that is the F, and we get the output Y. And we can easily say that, and that Y is the green line. So whenever we give some input, if that input, that Y value is above the green line, we can say that it is the belong to the class 0. If it is the below the green line, we can say that it is the class 1. So that's in that way that artificial neural network can classify that two different categories of inputs. Now we can, if we observe that Y equals to W1 X1 plus W2 X2 plus B, so it is similar to the equation of the state line, Y equals to MX plus B. So that means that neural network, it created a class boundary. It generates a class boundary, and that boundary is decided. Above the boundary is the one class, and below the boundary is the another class. Now we are coming to the activation function. What does it mean, the activation function? Activation function, basically, it is the extra force or extra effort applied to the need input to extract the output, to obtain an output, exact output. And it introduced some non-linearity in the output of the neuron. Activation inputs impose some non-linearity into the output of the neuron, and that non-linearity transformation make the neural network to capable to learn from the input and perform more complex tasks. So there are two different categories of activation functions are there. One is the linear activation function that are not very much used, and another is the non-linear activation function that are widely used. And the step function, I'm not discussing all these activation functions, I'm discussing some of the activation functions. The step function, this is the linear activation function. In that function, what we use? We use if the fx equals to 1, if x is greater than equals to theta, otherwise we will set to 0. So theta is the threshold. We are using some threshold. If the value of the x is greater than the equals to the threshold, we will set the output of the neuron is 1, otherwise set the output of the neuron is 0. That is the linear activation function. And for the non-linear activation function, there are a large number of activation functions are there. The sigmoid, one of the popular activation function, is the sigmoid activation function. It is like that fx equals to 1 by 1 plus e to the power minus x. And it is the just a curve generate the output as a, like a car, S curve. And another type of SCAP of type of activation function is there, TAN hyperview activation function. Another popular activation function is the ReLU activation function, where fx equals to max of 0 and x. And it is another popular activation function from the artificial neural network, or you can say that the deep learning models. Although the graph shows like a straight line, but it is all it is a non-linear activation function, and there are some problems that they are in the ReLU activation function. That's why the leaky ReLU is developed. The in case of the leaky ReLU, fx equals to ax, a is the some arbitrary parameter, a is some arbitrary parameter, and if x less than 0, then fx equals to ax, otherwise fx equals to x. So these are the activation function. Now we have already told that there is a bias will be there. What is the role of the bias? Why you have to add the bias in the as the input of the artificial neural network? Bias play a very important role. In addition, it is an additional parameter is incorporated in the neural network, which is used to adjust the output along the weighted sum of the inputs of the neuron. Say, take suppose we are going to consider an example. Suppose we have data points are some data points are there. Some of the circles are there, red circles are there. Some of the blue squares are there. And we have developed a artificial neural network model that doesn't have any bias. So if the network, the model does not have any bias, the output of the neuron, output of this artificial neural network must be, it is the equation like y equals to mx, so it will be go through the origin of the graph, go through the origin of the graph. So if it is go through the origin of the graph, in that case, the slope is correct. If the model is correctly identify the slope of the curve, slope of the that line, but it is not able to actually classify that two different categories of inputs. And here, the purple line, here the purple line shows that y equals to mx, that means the model without any bias. Now, if we add some bias, and the bias who shifted the line from the positive or the negative direction, and it is the extra force that is used to correctly classify the models. So if we add some b, y equals to mx plus b, so b is shifted the graph, shifted the line, purple line in the two some distance, and that distance and that green line is the y equals to mx plus b, that is the model with the bias, and that can classify the two different categories of input successfully or successfully. Okay, so that is the utility of the bias. So if sometimes that can move to the upper direction, or that can be moved to the purple line can be moved to the lower direction based on the requirement of the model or to classify the data points. So that is the utility of the bias. Now I'm going to implement a simple AND logic. All of you know what is the AND logic, and the truth table of the AND. All of you know that truth table of the AND. There are two inputs are there, x1 and x2 inputs are there, and the y is the output. We know the truth table. If the both the inputs a zero, in that case the output will be this is the OR logic. If there are two inputs are there, zero zero are there, the output is zero. Otherwise, if any one of the inputs are one, then the output will be one. That is the wrongly written, that is the AND logic. Now I'm going to implement that thing by using the artificial neural network. How can you implement that thing? So if I plot the output, we can say that the blue circles are the one, and the red circle is the one. So the task of this model, we have to develop the artificial neural network model that generate a classification boundary, and that classification boundary is classify or does segregate the zeros and the ones. So here, that is the y line is here, and the y line is segregated zeros and ones. That means the blue circles and the blue circles and the red circles. So there is a simple two input artificial neural network can be used for that purpose. Now we are coming to the XOR. XOR output, already we know what is the XOR, and that is the truth table of XOR. In case of the XOR, if both the inputs are zero, in that case output is both the inputs are same, the output is zero. If any one of the output is both the outputs are the different, in that case both the inputs are different, the outputs are one. So that is the logic. If we plot that thing in the graph, we can see that these are the blue lines are the blue dot circles are the one, and the red circles are the zero. Now how can you classify that? Can you generate a single boundary, single classification boundary to classify that to different categories of output? It is not possible. So how can you implement that thing? By using the artificial neural network. So in that case, we introduce a new layer, that is the hidden layer within the network. Now the hidden layer, that is the Z1 and Z2, are the hidden nodes or hidden neurons of the network. Now Z1, if I use the Z1, the output is Z1, output of the Z1 is plotted that line in the lower graph, lower right graph. We can see that the Z1 is this one line, and the Z2, output of the Z2, is in at this line, and the output neuron Y, the final output of the output neuron Y, that is the plot, that is the shaded portion, that is the shaded portion within the two boundaries. Now that two lines easily segregate the zeros and the ones, or easily classify the two different type of categories. So if we have that type of problem, in that case we have to introduce a hidden layer. Now this type of problem can be used by adding a single hidden layer, but sometimes it is not possible to distinguish, or not possible to categorize that output into the two-dimensional structure. In that case, we have to add more hidden layers, and that means we can add the more dimension of the model and higher dimension. In the higher dimension, we use the hyperplane to distinguish or to segregate or to separate that the inputs. So that are the purpose of the hidden layer. So if it is not possible by the two-dimensional structure, we increase the more hidden layers to increase the more dimension of the model, and that higher dimensional, that is possible to distinguish or possible to segregate that different type of inputs. Okay, that is the utility, or that is the useness of the hidden layer in the model. Now learning, what does it mean, the learning? The network is learn the value, learn from the parameter, learn from the inputs, and that knowledge is used for that knowledge can be used to for some unknown inputs to give the output. So that is the main thing of the artificial neural network model, that is the learning capabilities. There are the suitable differences between the learning and memorizing. If the memorizing means, if we are remember, suppose I'm giving you are giving me a single word, I am memorizing that word. When I have asked to say, I can give that repeat that word. But learning means we are gathering the knowledge in spite of memorizing this thing. So that knowledge can be not only that knowledge can be implemented, or knowledge can be used or to for some unseen situations. That is the process of the learning. And artificial neural network, that learning models learn in the form of the parameter weight. The weight is the W1, W2, like that. So these are the weights between the interconnection of the two neurons, and that weights is the basically the learning parameters, and that weights value are in the form of the learning features. Now that learning of artificial neural network, the three different type of learning are possible. One is the supervised learning, another is the unsupervised learning, and the last one is the reinforcement learning. So first of all, I'm giving you the simple the supervised learning. Discuss the supervised learning. What is supervised learning? Basically, supervised learning is done under the supervision of the teacher. There is a teacher, and whenever we have doing some teacher asks me to solve a particular problem, I am solving that problem, I am giving the output, and teacher check that whether this output is right or wrong. If it is wrong, then again I am doing the same problem again until the output become correct, and that is the continuous process. So teacher in that case teacher is always helping us to generate the right output. That means this type of learning is the dependent learning. In the picture below, we can see that the that means that network, that neural network, that type of neural learning model take the feedback from the environment. Suppose some input is given there, that neural network performs some output, that is the actual output. That is the actual output is generated by the neural network. Then actual output is checked with the desired output. What the output actually, what the output will be. And that will check. That is the desired output. If that is not same as the desired output, the error signal is generated. That error signal basically is the D minus one, desired output minus the actual output, and generated to the back to the neural network. And neural network is adjust its weights to learn from the features. And again, it generated the output. And that process will continue. That means there is a teacher. Teacher is always helping to generate the correct output. And second one is the unsupervised learning. In that unsupervised learning, that type of learning is done without any supervision of the teacher. That is the independent learning. Independent learning. Independent learning means, suppose in our early childhood days, when a baby started his walking, he has developed that features or developed the learning process with his own. Say baby fish started swimming. So that is that they have developed that features of swimming, technique of swimming, developed the technique of swimming their own. So that type of learning is called the unsupervised learning. There is no teacher is involved there. So in that case, similar type of things, similar type of inputs are grouped together. In case of unsupervised learning, similar types of things are grouped together. And when a new input is given, and based on that groups, it will assign a particular group. So that type of learning is called the unsupervised learning. Another type of learning is the reinforcement learning. Reinforcement learning, there is a reinforcement signal is applied. So it is more or less similar to the supervised learning. In case of the supervised learning, exact or desired output is given. Here the desired output is not given. Here the critique information is given. Critique information, and the model is generated the output, and that output, it takes the information, critique information or reinforcement signal from the environment and check whether the there is a error or not. Recognition that whether there is a error or not. If it is the model itself not satisfied, then the error signal is generated and model again try to build a new modify its weights and develop the new generate a new output. And that is that in that way you continue to learn. Simple, I can give you a simple example. I'm giving the lecture to you, deliver the lecture. Someone can say that this lecture is not so good. Someone can say that it may be better, or it may be there is a chance of a lot of betterness. So no one giving the output like that, whether my lecture is the good or bad. So from that, that is the critique information, and I am accepting that critique information. Now I have to judge whether that is the satisfactory output is generated or not. If it is satisfactory output generated, then it is okay. If it is the I am recognized that satisfactory output is not generated, then I have to rebuild the model we have to adjust the weights and the bias. So that is the reinforcement learning. Sometimes there are another type of learning is there. Some say that is the semi-supervised learning is also there. Basically, it is the in case of the semi-supervised learning, we can say there are say large volume of data set is given, and out of that large volume data sets, only few data sets the output is desired output is known, and the lot of data and remaining data sets the desired output is not known. In that case, we can use the semi-supervised learning. Okay, so there are three different, mainly there are three different categories of learning. Now, what is the learning rule? There are the variety of learning rules are there in artificial neural network. Basically, the learning rules or learning process is the method or a mathematical logic that improve the artificial neural network performance. The learning rules update the weight and bias level of the network. It apply the learning rule. We apply the learning rule in the iterative process. The learning is the iterative process. That means the continuous process, and that helps the neural network learn from the existing conditions and improve the performance. That are the three, that are the four features of the learning rules or the learning rules have. And there are the variety of learning rules are in artificial neural network. So there are the Hebbian learning rules are there. There are the perceptual learning rules are there. There are delta learning rules are there. Correlation learning rules there. Austral learning rules there. And there are many more learning rules are there. You can go through any books, or you can go through the internet. You can search the learning groups and you can learn the different type of learning groups. Now, in the next thing I'm going to discuss, that is the perceptual learning rule. How the network, how a single output class of the artificial neural network model can be trained using the perceptual learning rule. That is basically the perceptron training algorithm. So first of all, what do you have to do? We have to initialize the weight bias and the learning rate alpha, and generally we use the random value, set the random value of weight bias and the learning rate. Generally learning rate values always will be the less than equals to 1 and greater than equals to 0. Now we have that type of learning rule, perceptual learning rule, used for the supervised learning. So we have a data set S, basically the training vectors pairs, that is the S and T. S is the input data set, input vector, and the T is the target vector, or these are output vector. Target vector or these are output vector. And for each pair of X, T, we assign S within the X. Now we calculate the net input Y in the form of the b, by using the equation y in equals to b plus summation of 1 to n xi wy, and the wy is the weight, and b is the bias, and the n is the total number of input neurons in the network. Now after that net input, we apply some activation function. Here in the perceptron neural network, we apply the activation function y equals to f of y in equals to 1 if the y in is greater than theta. If it equals to 0, if y in is greater than equals to minus theta and less than equals to theta, and it is the minus 1 if is the y in is less than minus theta. Here the theta is the threshold. So based on that, we use the output y, generate the output y. Now based on that output, we will that learning rules used to modify, learning will try to modify the OS of the neuron. So if y equals to not equals to t, that means the desired output is not same as the exact output or actual output. In that case, the new weight will be calculated. So wi is the new weight, wi new equals to the wi old plus alpha t xi. Alpha is the learning rate, t is the target output, and xi or desired output, and xi is the input. And b new equals to b old plus alpha t. And if y equals to t, then the weight and the bias will not be adjusted. The same weight and bias will be used, and that process will be continued until the for all the inputs, until for all the inputs there is no changes of weight. That is the stopping condition over here. If there is no changes of the weight, we'll stop over here, and that means the model is learned. Then we can give a new input to the model, and model can give the output. So that is the perceptron training algorithm for single output class neural network model, artificial neural network model. Okay. So that is the first part of my lecture. Now I'm going to enter into the second part of my lecture, that is the deep neural network. Now what does it mean, the deep neural network? Basically it is a simple neural network. If the neural network have more than two hidden layers, we can say that it is the deep neural network. Two or more hidden layers introduced into the network, then we can say that it is the deep neural network. And all the other features are remain same, but the number of hidden layers is increased. If the number of hidden layers is greater than equals to 2, we can say that it is the deep neural network. And each layer perform specific type of sorting, ordering in a process. Some refers as that is called the feature hierarchy. And that type of neural network is called, so deep neural network, basically DNN, is called the deep learning. It is called the deep learning. So if a neural network has more than two hidden layers, we can say that this is the deep learning model. Now we are coming to the next slide. In that slide, we can see what is the position of the deep learning in the field of the artificial neural network. The artificial neural network is the built old in this field of artificial intelligence, in the field of intelligence, computational intelligence, and that deep learning is the core part of the machine learning. So machine learning, first of all, the artificial neural network is developed. Artificial intelligence model is developed, and then within that artificial neural network, next is the machine learning is developed, and after that, now we are in the era of the deep learning. Deep learning basically it is the proper subset of the machine learning, and people are interested about the deep learning compared to the machine learning because there are some certain reasons are there. The deep learning is gaining much more popularity due to their supremacy over the in terms of the accuracy over the different type of learning algorithms when the data set is huge. So if the data set is large, in that case the deep learning is produce much more accurate result or their performance compared to the other learning algorithms. That's why people are shifted to the different type of learning, to the deep learning. I'm giving you the simple example, difference between the deep learning and the machine learning in the given picture. In the machine learning, first of all, we give some input, and from that input, we have to extract the features. Based on the features and the feature extraction phase, we need the expert of the domain expert knowledge. The person which has the knowledge about that input. We have to incorporate that person. We have to take help from that person, and we have to extract the features. And that feature engineering, after the feature extraction, then that features is incorporated, or that features is given to the some classification model, and that classification model can give can produce the output. So in that case, I'm giving the input, and input is the picture are as the input, and that model is distinguished whether it is a car or not, and that is type of. So feature extraction is the important part of the machine learning algorithm. So that means whenever, say I'm giving you a simple example, suppose we have to check whether x-ray plate, we have an x-ray plate, x-ray image, and we have to check whether the fracture is occurred or not. So in that case, what we have to know, we have didn't any idea about the x-ray plates, graphics of the x-ray plate. So we have to take the help of the technician or the doctors about the different features of that image, and from that features they will help to extract the features, and after that features is extracted, that will be incorporated in the model, and then model will able to decided whether this fracture is occurred or not. But if we are using the deep learning model, in that case what happened, no feature extraction is needed. The model itself learn the features from the input data patterns. So that's why the deep learning model has become much more popular compared to the machine learning model. And in that picture, we can easily see that the feature extraction and the classification part is incorporated in the model. The models have the itself have the capability to extract the features and the classify the picture or classify the image based on that features. Now I'm giving you some of the statistics about the uses of the machine deep learning, and this is the graph that is quite old. It is up to the 2017, and Google trends, deep learning trends in the Google, and 2000 it is from the 2011 to 2017 data. We can see that as the year progresses, the deep learning approaches, trend of the deep learning in the Google is increased. That gives the immense idea about that, how the deep learning is, how the people are using the deep learning. And another picture I'm showing the below here, the performance and the data, amount of data is plot against the performance, and amount of data against the performance is given. And we can see that the red line is the deep learning curve, where the amount of the data is increased, the performance of the model is still increasing. We give the more data, the model give the more accurate result. Whereas for other learning algorithms, after certain amount of data, it is saturated. The performance has been saturated. That means it is just like a straight line. So there is no improvement of the performance. So in that from that two pictures, we can see, we can conclude that the deep learning has the much more advantageous if we have the large data sets, then it can be produce a better result compared to the other learning algorithms or other learning models. Now, when we have to use the deep learning model? Deep learning, one of the limitation of the deep learning model is that if we have a limited number of data, in that case, the machine learning is much more better, much more advantageous compared to the deep learning. But if we have a large data sets, a large volume of data sets, in that case, we can use the deep learning model than the machine learning model. Another limitation of the deep learning is that the higher infrastructure. That means we need a high-end machines. The machines with the high computational capabilities, modern days the GPU-based machines, we require the GPU-based machines, and that requires a large amount of time for the execution, for the training of the model. So that is the another things. If we don't have that type of machines, in that case, we can go for the machine learning in spite of the deep learning. And when we have the lack of domain expert knowledge, in that case, we have to go to the deep learning approaches rather than the machine learning approaches. Now, the deep learning models is deployed for the three different type of categories of problems. Deep learning models can be used for the three different categories of problems. One is the regression problem, and there's the classification problem, and last one is the clustering problem. And the regression type of problems, we can use the supervised learning as well as the unsupervised learning. And for classification problems, we can use supervised as well as the unsupervised learning. And for the clustering problems, we can use only the unsupervised learning. Now, what is the regression? So if we have a continuous response values, in that case, we have to use the regression type of problems. So if predict the continuous values, we have to predict the continuous values. Say we have to predict the time series. So in that case, we have to use the regression problem. We have to use the model that's suitable for the regression type of problems, or that type of models is called the regression models. Say, what is the time series? Time series, basically the data points is collected over the fixed time intervals. Suppose, I'm going to collect the weather data for fixed time for every hour. So that is the time series data. Suppose I'm going to collect the stock market for every day. So that is the time series data. So that means the data is collected over the time. So the fixed time intervals that are called the time series data. For any time series forecasting problem, we have to use the regression model. So price of the house of a specific city, in that case, we have to use the regression. What is the value of a stock? In that case, we can use the regression. So that are the regression type of problem. Okay. Now, the classification problem. When we have to predict the categorical response, whether it belongs to, suppose we have given some input data and we have to distinguish whether it is belong to which class. So in that case, type of category, it belong to which category. In that case, we have to use the classification type of class that is considered as the classification problem, and we have to use the classification models. That are the models, deep learning models that are suitable for the classification purpose. So there is a simple one class problem or a two class problem I'm already shown in my previous slides. So there is given that say that is the class boundary, and if the data points is belong to that upper that class boundary, that is belong to that class, and if lower that boundary, that is belong to that class. Where it is used. So basically, suppose we have to check whether the mail is spam or not, say whether today will be rain or not, whether the picture is car by cat or not. This is basically the two type of two class problem, that there may be the more than different classes of problems. So 3 class, 4 class, 5 class problems can be there. So this is the classification. And next one is the clustering. Clustering basically we groups the similar type of things together. If we have to group the similar type of things together, in that case, we are using the clustering. suppose we have given the news articles and we have to cluster into the different type of news. Suppose some of the tweets are there, we have to cluster based on the content of the tweet. Suppose we have some images. We have to cluster them into the objects present in the images. So there are different. These are the clustering problems. Now, there are a lot of deep learning models are there. Deep learning algorithms are there, and I'm not going to describe all these deep learning algorithms. Some of the popular deep learning I'm going to describe some of the popular deep learning algorithms: the convolutional neural network, recurrent neural network, autoencoders, and the generative adversarial networks, that is the GAN. Now, the first one is the convolutional neural network. It was developed in 1980s by Yan Li Kun, and that is the one of the biggest achievement in the field of the computer vision. It's makes a revolution in the field of the computer vision, and that gives the immense success in the image classification, image recognition type of problems. This CNN, basically CNN has a four different type of layers: convolution layer, activation layer, pooling layer, and the fully connected layer. And mainly this is CNN is used for the image classification or image recognition. So if we give some image as the input here, we give the image as the input. So image can be the grayscale image or can be the a pitch color image, colored image. So if it is the grayscale, so image is represented in the form of the two-dimensional structure, in the form of the pixels are there, two-dimensional matrix of pixels. If it is the grayscale image, so the pixel values is 0 to 255. Or if you are using the colored image, in that case there is the RGB structure. That means that is three layers will be there, three two-dimensional layers will be there. Basically, it is the three-dimensional structure. The depth will be the three layer, and R is the one layer, G is the other layer, and the B is the other layer. More or less, both are the same. That is the two matrix structure, and with the some pixels are there. In the convolution layer, there is a filter, or sometimes called the kernel. Kernel is there, and kernel. A stride over kernel is basically a two-dimensional filter. It is a two-dimensional filter that can be the 3x3 or 5x4 or any other. So that kernel is stride over the input images. Image matrix, and perform the convolution operation. Convolutional operation. What is the convolutional operation? Convolutional operation, basically it is performed. The kernels have the kernel is the 3x3 kernel. So there is the three rows and the three columns. There are basically nine cells are there, and every cell is the weight. And that weight is multiplied with the weight, corresponding weight of the window of the input image or input matrix. Multiply that weights with the pixel values, and after that multiplying all that corresponding weights and the pixel values, it sum up that things, and that is the output of that net input of that convolution operation. A net output, and the convolution layers or filters, that kernel or filters is tied over the pictures from bottom to top to bottom and right to left. In that way, it can generate the sum of the values. Now that output summing up all the weights and the pixel values, multiplication of weights and pixel values, that output is passed as the activation layer. Activation layer perform some add some non-linearity within that net input. Within the net input, add some non-linearity. Basically, that non-linearity is used to extract more complex features from that image, and that is presented in another two-dimensional matrix. So from that picture, so there, if there is a window, there is a window, and the filter is slide over that window, is overlapping on that window, and perform that operation, and that is the output from that window, we get the output. Basically, it reduce the dimension, reduce the sum of the dimension of reduce the dimension of the input matrix. Now next layer is the pooling layer. basically polling layer is also used to reduce the size of the window, reduce the size of the matrix. More size reduction is being performed by the polling. And here, the max polling function is used. Max polling function within that window of the output window of that activation layer or convolutional layer and the activation layer, that polling layer find a within a window, find a maximum value or within the window, and that will be put it in the next two-dimensional structure or next matrix. Basically, it utility of the max polling is to find out the most prominent features from that window, and then after the fully connected layer, basically fully connected layer, simple as the perceptron neural network. There are the so in that fully connected layer, that two-dimensional structure is converted into the single layer, and is converted into the a vector, and that vector is generated an output. That can be the multi-class output, or that can be the two-class output, two or more class output. So that is the if we have we can develop a model by using the two or more convolutional layer or activation layer, that will be suited based on your requirements. You can use that one. Not only that, there will be the sequence of four layers will be there. You can introduce more convolution and the activation layers. Here the two convolution and the two convolution layers and the polling layers, then are used. Then the fully two fully connected layers, and then output layers are outputs is generated that are used. Now in the output, if they are the multi-class output, then every neuron, output neuron generates some output. The output neuron whose weightage is maximum, that will be treated as the output class. That will be treated as that picture is belong to that class. That the way that can classify the image. Now, the next part, we are coming to the recurrent neural network. The recurrent neural network is initially developed in 1980s, but it's become much more popular in the year of 1990s when the LS team is developed. And that recurrent neural network mainly used for the regression type of problems. Regression type of problem, that means the forecasting type of time series forecasting problem. And here we have three layers. One is the input layer, another hidden layer, and the output layer. This is the picture of the simple recurrent neural network. The X is the input, and the U is the weight associated between the input layer and the hidden layer S. B is the weight associated between the hidden layer S and the output layer O. And in recurrent neural network, there is a cell loop connection. The hidden layer of itself is connected with, there is a cell loop format. So that weight is the W. Now, suppose we have to use, suppose we have to predict, the PM2.5. Suppose I'm going to predict the pollution. So PM2.5 is one of the important pollutant, and we want to check, we want to say predict the PM2.5. And how can you, how we want to predict based on the previous, suppose based on the previous 3 days, previous 3 hours PM2.5 values, we want to predict the next hour PM2.5 values. So in that case, recurrent neural network will be unfolded into three different layers like that. So this is the unfolded, the right hand side is the unfolded structure of the model, recurrent neural network, where xt is the minus one is the input, t is the time, xt minus one, xt, and xt plus one is the input, and ot one, ot minus one, ot, and ot plus one are the outputs. And ht minus one, ht, and the ht plus one, these are the hidden layers. Now, in a particular time moment, the hidden layer out, the ht is calculated by some function fs of uxt plus w ht minus one. That means that not only the current input, it at the same time it use the previous input. So whenever we are considering the time series, in that case, the output is not only depend on the current data, it is also depend on the previous data. So that is incorporated over here, and the output ot is some function of fo of VST. So these are the, in that way, that recurrent neural network can be used. And that simple recurrent neural network can have the problems, can suffer, has different type of problems. There are two problems are there in the simple neural network, recurrent neural network. That is the vanishing gradient and exploding gradient. I'm not going to discuss about that that type of problem. So for that, to overcome that problem, two variation of the RNA have developed. That is the LSTM, long short-term memory recurrent neural network. Another is the GRU, gated recurrent neural network. That two variation of the RNA is developed later, and that overcome the difficulties of the RNA. And nowadays, any type of regression type of problem, in that case we can use the LSTM or the GRE. Now another is important or another popular deep learning architecture is the autoencoder. Autoencoder, basically it is the unsupervised algorithm. It is used for the unsupervised algorithm. There are three parts. One is the encoder part, another is the code part, and last one is the decoder part. What does it? It basically used to dimensionality reduction purpose. We give some input. Suppose we given some images. By encoder, the compress the image in the lower latency space or lower dimension. The code next is that is the code, and that code is used to give the is used as the input of the decoder. And the decoder is a decode that compressed image to get the exact output image. And that process, this is the continuous learning process. And in that process, the network learn what are the inputs is given. Then it generates the output, same output. If the input and output both are same, then the learning each process is complete. Then we can give the new inputs to the model. Model can compress that thing, and that compressed image can be used. So that basically that is the dimensional reduction purpose we can use. Basically, one other important example is the compression of the image, image like that. Okay, and that also can be used compared with the we can compare it the feature extraction feature capability with the machine learning algorithm. That can be used as the feature extraction. So if the code is the feature, basically the code is the feature from the input image or input data. We get the code encoder, get the code. And code we get the output. When the input and product both the same, model has learned perfectly, and we given the summary of the input, and we generate the code that is the features of that input, and that features can be used for any other purpose. So this is the auto encoder. There are the different varieties of auto encoders are there. I am not going to discuss these varieties of the auto encoders now. Another popular deep learning algorithm is the generative adversarial neural network networks. That is the GAN. GAN was introduced in 2016 by the Ian Gottfried. And in GAN, there are two parts. One is the generator and the discriminator. And the generator, what does mean? We give some input to the generator, and at the same time we can give some noise also. And from that input and noise, the generator is generate some fake images or fake samples. We give some input samples, and from that input samples, generator generates some fake samples. And that fake samples are given to the discriminator, and the fake samples and the as well as the inputs are given to the discriminator, and discriminator but try to identify the fake samples from the input samples. So there is always between the competition between the generator and the discriminator. Wants to generate becomes more powerful, and the discriminator wants to become more powerful. That's the generator wants to become more powerful, so that the generator can generate more fake images that is more or less similar to the fake samples that are more or similar to actual samples. And the discriminator wants to become more powerful that they can extract, they can distinguish, or they can identify the fake images, fake samples from the input samples. So there is always a competition, and ultimate battle will win by the generator. Generator will win the ultimate battle. So always the generator try to fool to the discriminator to making the samples, and when the generator become discriminator become a full, in that case the model learning is complete. Now the model can generate more synthetic data from the input data sets, that is the purpose of the utility, or that is the functionality of the GAN. Now I'm showing you with some of the pictures. In 2017 March, the fake or synthetic image generation has been started, and initially it was developed the 128 by 120 image. That is the image. This one is the image 128 by 128. So that are the good enough. In 2017, the GAN can produce the images of 1024 by 1024 more pixels, more with the more pixels or more resolutions. So these are the pictures in the right hand side. These are the pictures generated by the GAN. We can easily say that these are some of the celebrities of Hollywood, but actually these are not. These are the synthetic images generated by the GAN. These are not any actual real persons. These are the synthetic images. So how powerful GAN is. Similarly, that GAN can be used for the say animated images. For the animation purpose, there are a lot of images can be developed. And so that in the left hand side, we can see that the GAN, the generated samples, animated images, sample animated generated by the GAN. So how powerful that is, that shows the how powerful the GAN is. Now, how can you deployment that deep learning algorithm? To deploy the deep learning algorithm, that means any deep learning project, what are the steps we have to follow? That is the last part of my lecture. Now, to deployment of the deep learning, the steps are, first of all, we have to collect the data collection, and the construction of the data set is required. So what type of problem we are going to solve by using the deep learning? And we have to collect the large amount of the data from that field, and we have to construct the data set. After construction of the data set, we have to follow the data pre-processing. Basically, whenever we are collecting the data are collected from the different sources, and there may be some noises, there may be some missing values. The data pre-processing is the process by removing the noises, and we have to remove the noises, and we have to fill up the missing values, otherwise the model will not able to learn perfectly. So that is the important step. Another thing is that data pre-processing, data normalization or data standardization. If we are using the deep learning model, the data normalization is an important part, because the data can be scattered over the wide range. So to speed up the learning process, we have to scale down the data to a certain range, and that is the data normalization. So data normalization, there are the variety of the data normalization techniques that are there. You can select any one of them for your data normalization technique. After the normalization of the data, what do you have to do? We have to basically data pre-processing. What do you have to do? We have to divide the entire data set into three different data sets. First of the training data set, validation data set, and the testing data set. In general, for the deep learning for deployment of any deep learning model, 70 to 80% of the data will be used as a training data set for the training purpose, and 15 to 10% of the data will be used as a validation, and 15 to 10% of the data will be the testing purpose. Now the next part is the model selection. What are type of problems we are going to solve by using the deep learning architecture, and depending on that model or depending on that problem, we have to select what type of model we have to use. If we are going to use the regression type of problem, in that case we have to select the models that are suitable for the regression purpose. If we are going to use the classification, so that the classification models we have to select, and you can use the combination of different type of models as well. And the next, the selection of the optimization technique and the performance metrics. Optimization technique, basically it is the mathematical logic. Optimization techniques, basically how the weights and the bias values will be adjusted. during the training phase, that is decided. And the performance metrics, when you want to evaluate the performance of your metrics, what will be the your performance criteria? Say, if we are using the regression type of problem, so prediction type of problem, in that case, my performance criteria can be the mean square, root mean square error, say RMSE. My performance criteria can be the mean absolute value, like that. If we are using the classification type of problem, my performance criteria can be the accuracy, precision, like that. Now, we have to train the data, train the model by the training data set. And after the training is successful, that means we are getting the when during the training phase we are satisfactory, we get the satisfactory performance of the model, we stop the training. Then we have to validate the performance by using the validation data set, and we use the input data set as the validation data set as the input, and we want to validate the data model. And for the validation, there are different type of validation techniques are there. One of the popular validation technique is the K-fold validation technique, K-fold cross validation technique, that can be used also. After the validation successfully validate the model, and we can use the test data set to analyze the performance. We test the model by the test data set, and we can analyze the performance of the model. So that are the steps we have to follow to deployment any of the deep learning models. Now, during the training phase, the main motto of the training phase to identify the dominant features from the training data set. What are the features, dominant features? They are maybe the large features from the input data set, and the model should be able to find the dominant features. And based on the dominant features, model able to categorize or generate the output. And it can predict the likely output of an input that it has never seen before. And whenever we are dealing with the training phase, there are the two major problems can be suffered by the training phase. One is the overfitting problem, and another is the underfitting problem. The overfitting problem, that means if you learn the model, train the models with so many times, in that case, model not only capture the dominant features, at the same time, its model learn from the noise existing in the model data set. From that noise, it learns. So in that case, what happened? In that case, the model is giving the performance, very good performance for the training data sets, but are not able to give the desirable performance in case of the test data set. So that is the overfitting. So in the graphics, in the picture in the below, we can see the right hand side, we can see that the model is learned too well that it can easily classify the training data set, that means that they are classified as red circles and the green cross. But the appropriate fitting will be like that. How can you know that the model is overfitted? If we check with that, we can see that if in the training phase, this training errors is goes decreasing, but in the testing phase, the testing errors is increasing. In that case, we can say that the model is overfitted. Model is overfitted. In the graph above, in the picture above, we can see that the training goes decreasing, but the training error is goes decreasing, but the testing error is increasing. And optimal, we have to select the optimal fitting, that is the appropriate fitting. So that the perpendicular line, blue line, is the optimal fitting. This when the training error is low, at the same time, the test error is also low. Another, how can you overcome the that overfitting problem? The regular regression technique is the used to overcome from the overfitting problem. And there are varieties ways of regulation techniques. We increase the training data, that is called the data augmentation. We increase the training data set. It is always not possible. Second thing is the reduce the model complexity. We reduce the model complexity. And next one is the early stopping during the training phase. We can stop early. And the last one is the dropout. We can use the dropout technique. Dropout technique basically for every training phase, we in the output neurons about we select the randomly select some of the nodes, and remove the nodes from the remove the nodes that is used for the dropout. That also used for the overfitting problem. And another problem is the underfitting. So whenever we are using the early stopping criteria, that means we don't want to run the train the model so many times. In that case, what happened that the model may not capture the dominant features, and based on that, the model can categorize the inputs. So in that case, we can say that the model is underfitting. So the model must not be overfitted, and the model must be the underfitted. The optimal fitted will be the we have to train the model in the optimal fitted category. Now the optimization algorithm, already I have told what is the optimization algorithm. Basically, optimization algorithm, the methods are used to change the attributes of the neural network, such as the weights and the learning rate. And there are the variety of optimal learning optimization algorithms are there. I'm not going to discuss all these things. This is the out of scope of this lecture. So gradient descendant, there are some of the optimization algorithms are the gradient descendant, stochastic gradient descendant, mini batch gradient descendant, adaptive momentum estimation. Most of the deep learning model use the ADAM optimization technique, that is the adaptive momentum estimation optimization technique. And that's all my lecture, and if you have any questions, and you can ask.
Thank you, Mr. Shomit Bhanju sir, for your nice, valuable, informative lecture on artificial neural network and deep learning basics. Now we will start our interactive session. Moinak Mitro asks, what is binary associative memory?
Binary associative memory is one type of artificial neural network. I'm not discuss about the things, and you can basically it is a simple artificial neural network. There is a feedback is there. Feedback is there, and you can go for the any of the you can go for the internet, and you can go for the any book of the artificial neural network. You can see that. Basically, it is the one type of neural network that have the feedback, that is the binary associative. There is a lot of things are there. There are a lot of learning rules are there. I'm not going to discuss all these things.
There is no question. Next. Any other question? No, only one question is posted there. Okay. Another okay. Suggested any books on ANN and DL? Asked by Sandeep Tikka.
Suggested, sorry, I'm not getting.
Suggested books on for ANN and DL.
For the deep learning, for artificial neural network, first of all, you go for the there are a lot of books are available. One is book is the DIPA, SN DIPA is available, so you can go for that book. For the deep learning, so there is no such books are available in the market now. You can go for the internet. There are a lot of e-books are there. So there are a lot of prices there. So there may be the 50,000 or 40,000 price. So you go better to go for the deep learning. You go for the internet, and there are a lot of materials are there. You can study that materials, and you can learn from that materials. No show for actual reading purpose. There is no such books are available in the Indian market for deep learning.
That's all. Now, I would like to request our HOD, Mr. Sandeepan Basu, to conduct the Thanksgiving session.
Thank you, all the participants, for your interest and participation in this webinar. Thank you, Professor Shomit Bhanju, for your nice presentation that was a very introductory session on deep learning and artificial neural network. You also highlighted the different types of models available, and also mentioned few of the applications. I hope the participants enjoyed the session. Thank you all of you, and I would request all the participants to fill the feedback form. The link of the feedback form is given in the chat box. And only after that you will get the e-certificate. So kindly fill the feedback form. The link will be available for 2 hours from now on. And if any one of you have missed any portion of this webinar, the entire session will be available in our YouTube channel. So you can also visit that channel later, and you can view the video. So thank you. Thank you, Unkomda. Thank you, Shamidda. Thank you, all the participants. And I conclude this webinar. And also, I would like to announce that in the coming Saturday, we are also going to organize a webinar on blockchain and cryptocurrency. So kindly be there with us. Soon we will distribute the flyer. So we hope we will see you at there. Thank you.